So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So as most of you would be knowing that in this series we conduct a five question session and these questions they are usually related to finance and economics current affairs which can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So guys, before moving ahead to question number one, a brief introduction about your mentor. So I have done my graduation from Sri Guru Gobind Singh College of Commerce, University of Delhi, and after that I have pursued my post-graduation from Delhi School of Economics, and after doing that I have cleared GRF in Commerce as well as Management. So that was a brief introduction. So guys, are you ready for questions? And before moving to questions, I would like to ask you to do the customary thing. So guys, if you are a new entrant here and you are watching our video for the very first time, then do not forget to subscribe to our channel, because pressing the subscribe button can help you to associate with us, and pressing this bell icon can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up, right? So you can also join our Telegram group, and on this group you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So guys, moving straight away to question number one. So here is your question number one for today, which says select the correct statement about types of auctions. So a very simple question gives you five statements about different types of auctions, and you have to select the correct option. And the correct option for this question is option C. So option C means this statement, which is talking about reverse auction. So a reverse auction is a type of auction in which sellers bid for prices at which they are willing to sell their goods and services. So guys, before I discuss it with you, it would be better if you will look at this diagram. This is going to make everything clear to you. See, whenever a normal auction happens, what happens in it? There is a seller. So if you are a Bollywood fan like me, you must have seen in old Bollywood movies whenever any house or some expensive factory were getting auctioned, right? So purani movies mein dikhate the ki kaise neelami ho rahi hoti thi bade bungalow ki ya kisi factory ki, right? So this is the seller here who is trying to sell a particular asset, let's say a house, and there are interested buyers, right? So these buyers, they are trying to buy this house from the seller, and they quote their own prices, and the buyer who quotes the highest price, so here you can see the goal is to get the highest price. So the buyer who gets the highest price or who is willing to pay the most for this particular asset is going to win this auction or is going to win the ownership of that house, right? So this is a forward auction or a regular auction, which is also called as a forward auction. After that, coming to reverse auction, here you can see the reverse auction. In this, the situation is reversed. So there is one buyer who is trying to buy some asset, and there are different sellers who are interested to sell their asset to this particular buyer, and they are bidding, and whoever is willing to sell the asset at the lowest price is going to win the auction. Here you can see the goal is to get the lowest price in case of reverse auction, right? So since we were talking about movies, you must have seen that in movies many a times there are tenders invited for government contract. So whenever government wants to buy some goods or they want some service, they invite applications from people or from entities, from interested entities, and the entity who is willing to do that job at the lowest price. Let's say there is government and government wants to build a bridge. So they are going to invite applications from a number of companies who are into construction, right? So whoever is willing to build this bridge at the lowest price is going to win the auction, right? So obviously there can be many other considerations apart from price, right? So as we have seen in our previous sessions, that government awards these contracts on the basis of the degree of domestically produced goods that they use, right? So that is an entirely different concept, but we are here talking about auction based on price. So these are some basic concepts. I hope now you understand the difference between the two, right? So here you can see the correct option was a reverse auction is a type of auction in which sellers bid for the prices at which they are willing to sell their goods or services, right? Very simple question. So here you can see the difference between them. I think we have discussed most of the points here. Regular auction, seller puts up an item, buyers place bid, and highest bidder wins. So price is not always the deciding factor, as I just told you. Many are times when companies are being sold, so the interested buyers, whoever is going to provide most benefit to the employees of the company, can be a consideration or can be a factor for this auction, right? So it is not essential that every time the major factor, major deciding factor is going to be price. So it is not necessary. After that, here you can see reverse auction. Buyer puts up request, sellers place bids, amount that they are willing to be paid, or amount at which they are willing to offer their goods and services, and at the end of the auction, seller with lowest amount wins. So reverse auctions used by large corporations and government entities as a competitive procurement method, so that they can procure goods and services at competitive prices. Services like accounting and customer services, right? So I hope you are clear with the difference between them. So before going to question number 2, there is something called Dutch auctions. So guys, this is your question for today. You have to read that what are Dutch auctions and what is their meaning, what is its meaning, and how does it differ from these reverse and forward auctions, right? So I'll be waiting for your answers in the comment section. So I would like to take here Ishita's name, because Ishita has been constantly commenting with correct answers on videos. So guys, I want all of you to show such enthusiasm and explore the topics that I tell you about and mention it in the comments. So it is going to help you in peer-to-peer learning, where you can learn and share your knowledge with people who are preparing just like you, or applicants who are into studies just like you, right? So there is going to be exchange of knowledge, right? Moving ahead to question number 2. So here is a question number 2, which says the paradox of globalization by Danny Roderick talks about 3 arms of an impossible trinity related to globalization. And you have, okay, I think the question is a little bit incomplete. So you have to select here the arms which are not the part of these 3 arms of impossible trinity. So guys, I'm going to write it here. Select the incorrect arms out of these 4. So here it is being said that there are 3 arms in this impossible trinity. You have to select the incorrect one or ones out of these 4, right? Moving ahead to the correct option for this question. And the correct option for this question is option E. So option E. Option E means 3 and 4, they are the incorrect statements. So autonomous monetary policy and free flow of capital, not a part of this impossible trinity which talks about globalization. So guys, if you remember, in one of the previous sessions we have talked about one more impossible trinity, where we have learned that how government of a country cannot achieve 3 arms of a triangle, or 3 vertices of a triangle. That means if they have 3 goals that they want to achieve, they can at most achieve 2 out of it, but not all the 3, right? So I hope you remember that. So this is a different impossible trinity talked about in this question. This talks about an impossible trinity related to globalization. So let's see. Impossible trinity talks about 3 goals, out of which at most 2 are attainable. So this is a generic term, and here we are talking about a trinity related to globalization. And here the 3 arms or the 3 goals are mentioned to you here. First of all, hyper-globalization. After that, national sovereignty. And after that, democratic policies. So guys, see, What is being said here? That if there is a government which wants to make its economy more globalized or more entangled, more engaged or integrated with world economy, then they have to pursue a goal called hyper-globalization. And national sovereignty means they should retain the power to take some of their own decisions, or decisions which are based purely on the factors going on in their own country, right? So globalization trying to reconcile with the world, whereas national sovereignty trying to retain the decision making capability. After that, trying to maintain the democracy, that means taking decisions according to the public, right? Because the essence of democracy is to allow public to make decisions, right? So here Danny Roderick says that if a government tries to attain all three goals, they cannot do it. They can at most achieve two goals out of it. Sorry. Because see, first of all, if a government tries to maintain their democracy, that is, maintain the interest of public or take decisions according to the public opinion, and if they want to integrate their economy with the world economy, then obviously they would have to make some policies which are in balance or which are in reconciliation to their neighboring countries. That is why they would have to forego some of their national sovereignty. So if you remember, we talked about Eurozone in a session, how many countries use one currency, right? So in this, obviously, if they are using one currency, then every decision that one takes or one country takes affects the others also, right? That is why they have to follow some integrated policies. And if we want to follow hyper-globalization, or if we want to integrate our economy with the world, then the rules have to be similar, right? Then only it would be easier to trade, or it would be easier to have a free flow of capital and labor across the nations, right? So that is why forego some of national sovereignty, right? After that, if a country wants to maintain national sovereignty and democracy, then they would have to let go of their globalization dreams, because here obviously they are retaining their own decision making capability. They can take decisions according to their own will. They can move their interest rates, or they can make changes into their money supply as the economy requires. Then they would have to let go of globalization. After that, if they want to follow these two, that is hyper globalization and democratic policies, so if they want to have hyper globalization and national sovereignty at the same time, they would have to let go some of their democratic principles, or some of their democracy will have to be sacrificed in order to achieve globalization and national sovereignty, if they want to align both of them, right? So this is the impossible trinity, right? So here you can see global governance, when want to reconcile these two. After that, you can see Bretton Woods compromise. So this refers to a period when most of the countries, they had their exchange rate linked to gold, and gold was linked to dollar, right? So that is an entire story or episode into history. Let's not talk about it here because it is going to take a lot of time, right? And after that, golden straitjacket. So guys, this is a term that I would like you guys to find meaning to. Let's see who gets the correct meaning, and I think you will be able to find it easily, and you have to mention it in the comments, right? Moving ahead to the next question. So here is your question number 3 for today, which says, select the incorrect statement about Keynes' theory of inflation. So this has been asked by one of you in the comments, and that person wanted us to take this topic, right? So you have to select the incorrect statements. moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says that the correct option is option B. Option B means only 2 is incorrect, rest are correct, right? So 2, the correct one. Okay, so this question talks about Keynes' theory of inflation. So guys, whenever we talk about Keynes, so in one of our session we discussed about classical model of economics and Keynesian model of economics, right? So I would advise you to once watch this concept before moving ahead with this question. It is going to help you to understand it better, right? You can ask for its link. So guys, whenever we talk about Keynes and Keynesian model, any economic model that is based on Keynesian principles, one major factor here is demand. So Keynes focused a lot on the importance of demand, right? So when Keynes wanted to explain inflation, he did it with the help of demand, or he mentioned in simple terms that whenever demand is very high, the inflation is going to be high. So whenever demand for goods and services is high in the economy, then it is going to raise prices of goods and products, goods and services, leading to inflation, right? So this theory stresses on the fact that, okay, moving ahead to the solution, then we can come back to discuss these statements. So here you can see Keynes emphasized the increase in aggregate demand as the source of demand pull inflation. So inflation and the cause behind inflation. So basically Keynes said that the cause behind inflation is demand or high aggregate demand, right? So demand comprises of consumption, investment and government expenditure. So here these two are being talked about in private sector, private sector's consumption, private sector's investment and the expenditure that government makes. Although there is one more aspect to it, but here we are talking about these three. So when the value of aggregate demand exceeds supply, so let's just try to imagine it in simple terms, right? So there is a product that you really want to buy, right? Now there are many of your friends who want the similar product at the same time. Obviously the seller is going to sell the product to that buyer who is willing to pay the highest price, right? So that is why whenever there is demand for a product, it leads to increase in price. So whenever the demand exceeds the supply, it is going to lead to a rise in prices, which is known as the inflationary gap, right? So usually this is a self-correcting model, because demand rises, demand leads to rise in prices, then again this hike in price leads to fall in demand, and the economy is back to where it started from. But if there is full employment level, where there cannot be more output added to the employment level, then the result is going to be higher prices of goods and services for a longer period of time, leading to inflationary gaps. So in the Keynesian view, as long as there is unemployment, the change in income is in output, and once there is full employment, all is in price, right? So Keynes said that if any economy is not working on a full employment level, that is there is some sort of unemployment in the economy, then this increase in demand is going to increase to add to output. And why is this so? Because obviously if the demand is going to increase, then the producers will try to increase it. Demand is higher than the supply. That is why the difference is leading to inflation. But if the producers, they increase the supply, there is no gap and prices will be back to normal. But if, so this expansion of production is going to lead to creation of more employment, right? Because if there is demand, producers are going to expand to meet this demand. And how are they going to expand? By hiring new workers. And they can hire new workers as long as there is unemployment in the economy. So they hire new workers, increase their expansion, expand their capabilities and meet this demand level. right, preventing the increase in prices. But what if there is no one who is unemployed in the economy? Then producers cannot increase their production capability. That in that case, the demand rise is going to lead to increase in price, right? So this is what Keynes said. So Keynes told that, or Keynes said that in behind inflation, the main cause is demand at a full employment level in the economy, right? So moving back to the statements, so here you can see, so this theory stresses on the fact that fall in interest rate would in turn increase investment, which would raise aggregate demand. Also, there is one more thing that Keynes here talked about, that is interest rate. So Keynes said interest rate, they also play a major role in trying to reconcile demand and supply. So if interest rates are made to fall or interest rates are reduced, then it is going to lead to higher aggregate demand, because it is going to lead to easy borrowing will lead to investment, which would create income and which would raise aggregate demand. So this statement is correct. So the first statement, it says movement of interest rate by authorities will be negatively correlated with the idle stock of money in the economy. So guys, just try to pause the video and read the statement carefully. Here they are saying that if there is a huge idle stock of money in the economy, or there is much money which is left untapped in the economy, then obviously the authorities would want people to spend that money or invest that money. For that, they would have to reduce the interest rates, because as you can see here, interest rates, when made to fall, they lead to higher aggregate demand. So if there is a huge idle stock of money in the economy, authorities would try to reduce the interest rate so that it leads to lesser cost of borrowing, and this money, it is easier to utilize or invest it, right? And after that, if there is lesser stock of money or lesser idle money which is in the economy, then the interest rates can be increased, right? So there is a negative correlation. High idle money, lesser interest rate to make people invest that money, lesser idle money, higher interest rate so that people can accumulate their wealth rather than investing it, right? Okay. That is why this statement is correct. So the second statement says that movement of interest rate by authorities will be negatively correlated with the velocity of money circulation. So guys, now we are trying to relate movement of interest rate by authorities with velocity of circulation. So if the velocity of circulation is very high, that means money is changing hands at a very fast rate or at a very rapid rate. In this case, so if the velocity is high, that means money is changing hands at a very fast rate, which obviously means that money creation is going very fast. So if authorities want to prevent the overheating of economy, they would have to reduce the interest rates, right? Sorry, they would have to increase the interest rates. So if the velocity is high, authorities would want to increase the interest rate in order to prevent the economy from getting overheated. And if the velocity is low, that means money spending is low, as in current times, the velocity is low. In this case, authorities would like to reduce interest rate so that they can make the cost of borrowing cheaper, right? So you see, there is a positive relation, and here it is mentioned that it is negatively related. That is why the statement is incorrect. So I hope now you are clear with this question. Moving ahead to question number 4, here is question number 4, which says DASH is a Japanese term referring to a business network made up of different companies that have close relationships and sometimes take small equity stakes in each other, all the while remaining operationally independent. So it talks about a Japanese concept. Let's see what the correct answer for this is, and the correct option is option A. Option A means Kairetsu. So guys, see, for understanding this question, you would have to know a little bit about world history, right? So we are talking about the result of World War II when Japan was defeated and US was made responsible to stabilize Japan again after the destruction of World War II, right? So US, one of the winning parties, made responsible for restructuring one losing party, that is Japan, right? Simple. Now we are talking about, see, Japan used to be a very large scale economy or a very high growing economy before World War II, and they used to have big business houses or a big a group of businesses which were supporting each other, and this sort of group were known as Zaibatsu, right? So when Americans came to Japan after World War, they saw Zaibatsu as creating monopoly, because they were big business houses which were preventing the entry of smaller businesses in the country. So US thought that these Zaibatsus or big businesses, they are creating monopoly in the economy, which is not good for Japanese economy. That is why what they did was they broke down these Zaibatsus into smaller entities, right? After that, when US went home or the Americans went home, these smaller entities, they once again tried to group themselves into bigger groups, right? Although the structure was a little bit different, but they tried to expand themselves once again after the exit of Americans from Japan. And these groups were known as Kaidetsus. Right? So guys, do you remember from a scene in the robot movie, or you can say in many sci-fi movies, it is shown that how there is a robot which breaks down into smaller components and then changes the form or becomes a snake or becomes something else, changes the form, and all these broken down components, they once again join by changing form. So this is one analogy you can relate to this structure, that how Zaibatsus were broken down by Americans in Japan, and once again they reunited themselves into Kairetsus. So these Kairetsus are nothing but conglomerate or business networks made up of different companies having close relationships. So Japanese economy, it is based much on relationships, right? Sometimes take small equity stakes in each other. So in one Kairetsu, they can be one business into construction, one business into finance, one business into insurance, one can be a bank, right? So these are group of businesses. In one group, there are different. Usually there is a bank, one bank which is at the center, which caters to the financial requirements of all the other companies, right? Here you can see some information. Powerful families known as Zaibatsus once ran Japan's major industries. So many of the big industries in Japan currently, they belong to these groups. So companies like, which are very famous, Mitsui or Mitsubishi, they are nothing but Kairetsus, right? So Japanese corporations value close ties, as I just told you, right? Kairetsu system is structured along, so there can be two types in which this can be structured, horizontal or vertical. So horizontal means companies at a similar level, they come together, as you can see here. Horizontal Kairetsu characterized by alliance of different companies at same level of production from various sectors, including a bank. So they can be one construction company, one insurance company, one finance company, one bank, right? So all these at the similar level of production, they come together and make a horizontal alliance. Whereas if this is a vertical alliance, that means
there is one company producing raw materials, after that one engaged into distribution, one engaged into marketing, right, one engaged into assembling. Then these are at the different levels of production. It refers to a vertical pyramid soup, right? Forming an alliance limits the threat of competition, obviously leads to growth in their power and makes it easy to steer through difficult circumstances. More difficult for its members to be subject to takeovers and attempts by outsiders, right? Moving ahead. So before moving to next question, there is one term I would like you to find meaning to. This term. So you have to tell which country this term relates to, right? Moving ahead. So guys, this is the last question for today, which says SEBI has recently renamed the dividend options as DASH. Moving ahead to the solution. And the solution says that the correct option is option D. So option D means income distribution cum capital withdrawal. So before learning about this question, let us first understand the two types of mutual funds. Growth option and dividend option. So guys, these are very simple. See, whenever you invest in mutual funds, there can be different types of investors having different risk appetite. So one investor who wants a stable income, or who wants that money should come back to that particular investor in intervals of time, then they can invest into a dividend option. Because in dividend option, whatever profit a mutual fund earns, that is divided into unit holders of mutual fund according to time, right? You can see profits are distributed to the unit holders from time to time, right? But in case of growth option, this does not happen. In growth option, this money or the profit which is earned by the fund are reinvested into the business itself. So all profits made by the fund are plowed back into the scheme, right? So that they can grow faster. Right? So growth options. In growth options, obviously the NAV or the net asset value, you can understand it as a price for a mutual fund unit. This NAV grows over a period of time, because obviously more money is being invested and the profits are not being taken out of business and distributed to the unit holders. So you will have to redeem the units. So if you want to take your money out of the scheme, you will have to sell the units to realize the growth in the value of investment. Whereas in case of dividend options, you are going to get a periodic income from your investment without actually selling your units, right? So NAV of the fund always reduces by the dividend. So guys, do understand that here in growth option, the NAV remains high because no money is taken out of business. Whereas in dividend options, the NAV, it falls because some money is taken out of the business and distributed to the owners, right? So guys, these were the five questions for today. Just a second. Okay, here you can see now SEBI has come out with a new rule which says according to which options which were earlier called dividend options, they will have to be called income distribution and capital withdrawal, right? So the name of dividend options has to be changed to this, so that the investors, they properly understand that the income is going to be distributed and capital is going to be withdrawn whenever the money is given back to the shareholders, unit holders, in form of dividend, right? So this is done. So the main reason why SEBI has done it, very simple, to provide more transparency to the investor, so that investor makes a more informed and aware decision before putting money into some scheme. So that communication is better. Communication is better. Right? Dividends can be distributed from the gains from the mutual funds. So guys, these were the five questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then do not forget to give us a thumbs up, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. Until then, you take care of yourself, keep your studies going on, and I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.